All right, so in this topic, we're going to cover how VMs and different resources communicate within a VNet. So how VMs communicate to each other, how maybe a web app, how you might connect that to your VNet, and also how you might connect your on-premises environment to your VNet within Azure as well. So Kel, if you want to take us into a little bit deeper discussion there.
Sure. Yeah, so the concept of a VNet is not something that's new, right? We've had that in Azure for quite some time. Even from the beginning, but we used to have, like we mentioned earlier, the cloud services model. And in the cloud services model, the classic model, that's where basically virtual machines, as long as we put them in the same cloud service, they could communicate seamlessly, no problem. We then moved to regional VNets, and that's the new model going forward outside of classic. So in our ARM-based model, we basically build virtual networks, and then we can connect those, whether it's on-premises or whether it's just up in Azure, you know, so we could have multiple. And the idea is this. So essentially, we could create, let's say, multiple. We'll walk through a couple scenarios here, the first being just virtual machines, because that's easiest to kind of tackle first. So in this model, if we put multiple VMs inside, and we'll call this VNet 1, we'll call this VNet 2. So two different address spaces, right? We have two machines in this one, one in this in VNet 2. These guys will be able to communicate by default with no problem. So when they are spun up, their NICs are attached to that virtual network in an ARM-based model. Those things will be able to seamlessly communicate back and forth. This guy over here on the right side will not be able to, because basically there's a barrier between there because it's a virtual network. Now, what we can do to enable, you know, communication between those is actually build a tunnel between these two. So in that tunnel, it's kind of interesting. So this kind of carries over with our hybrid approach too. You can imagine if this is on-prem over here. So if we have an on-prem situation here and we have a little gateway device like a firewall or even a piece of software, we could use Windows Server to do it. We can actually build a tunnel too, like this. And so in that model, basically, we can build a, and this would be a IPsec tunnel, industry standard, pre-shared key, and we would basically enable communication between, you know, a virtual machine or a VNet that's running in Azure and on-premises. But like we said, we can also enable it between, and this is all up in the cloud, you know, so this is all Azure up here. And whether it's the same VNet or same region or different region, we can enable this kind of tunnel between there. And actually, in Azure, we can specify whether we want this to be IPsec or not. So if we don't want that overhead, which there's some overhead there for IPsec tunnels, if we said no, because it's all in Azure and it's all basically trusted up there, I can just go ahead and disable that and just have it be a network connection between those two without IPsec. Anytime we come out of Azure, though, if we're coming back on premises, then we have to have IPsec. There's no way to get around that. Now, the other interesting side of this is, so this is a way we could kind of composite and build different networks up in Azure and kind of segregate our networks. We talk in another module about NSGs or network security groups, and we can put those at kind of boundaries inside this diagram to kind of restrict traffic flow and those kind of things. But the other thing that's interesting to consider here is what if we had a web app, right? So we got this little web app running over here. And, you know, let's say this is our SQL server, right? So he's our SQL device. He's running over here in VNet 2, and this guy's provisioned. He has no VNet because he's bound to a public endpoint, and he talks to the internet. You know, over here is the internet. He doesn't have any way to talk back through here. There is a way for us to essentially do the same thing. So we can build a tunnel between these two so that this guy can communicate back to that SQL server and vice versa to make sure that we have data flow there. We obviously probably don't want to be sticking like SQL servers directly on the internet. Probably not a great idea unless we secure the endpoints with SSL and some of those techniques. But even in some of those cases, from a regulatory sense, maybe we need to keep it in a VNet and we need to keep it isolated. So in that way, we can specify that we have this nice endpoint here that we can do it. I'll pop over to the portal to show you where some of these features are. I have a couple of virtual machines running here, and if you pop into your virtual machines, you can actually see which VNet they're connected to. Give it a second to refresh. So here's our virtual network and our subnet that we're attached to. You can see we have NICs attached here. And right here, there's no UI for it right now to be able to attach this VNet to another VNet. We can do that through a script, and you would actually see the connection happening through there. So right now, we don't have that into portal. You do it through a script, and then you just see it displayed through the portal. The other thing to look at, though, would be the web app model that I mentioned. So we have a web app running here. And under the settings, if we go under, there's a section here for networking. Let me just slow down a bit. Right here's the networking. It's under the routing section. And when you go in there, you see you got all kinds of options. So we mentioned in another module the ASE, or the App Service Environment. That's an isolated, think of it as like a basically a container that has an application running inside it, has its own VNet. And so we can establish connection to there. We can use VNet, which we just talked about, so building basically a tunnel between our web app and the VNet. So we can communicate to IaaS, VMs, or other things that are inside of that VNet. And then we can do hybrid connections. So hybrid connections is a little bit different. Hybrid connections, you'll see it labeled as BizTalk services or BizTalk hybrid connections. And really what that's about is being able to use an agent on whatever the, let's say it's on-premises in this case. We had a machine running there. We could install this agent on it, and it would establish an outbound connection up to Azure, and then we can basically communicate with that thing through there. It's just a different model to use. It's more of an agent-based as opposed to something purely cloud infrastructure, if we're going to go that route. A couple other things to mention about VNets is, especially on the IaaS side, let's pop back into some of our IaaS. So one of the things is when you provision these things by default, if you use one of our Quick Start templates, you'll see that we get a public IP attached to it, which allows you to basically connect to this thing through RDP or whatever that you're doing when you first manage it. You could obviously tweak the ARM templates to remove public IP binding, because in ARM, remember, we're just a bunch of Legos, so we can pull pieces out. We could say, we don't even need a public IP on this. Just put it in this VNet, and then I'll attach to that VNet in some manner, whether it's a site-to-site tunnel or something like that. And basically, once I'm in that VNet, then I can communicate with it. But if you take a look, you can basically do a couple things with these public IPs. First off, like I mentioned, you can remove them or take them out of your template. But you can also request that they be reserved, because especially if you have something like a DNS server or something that you can't have changed, like an Active Directory server, something where the IP binding is very close to that virtual machine, we can't have it change all the time. In that case, we should probably use a reserved IP, and that's enabled through a script as well. We can basically reserve this public IP so that no matter what happens, we always get that same public IP. We can detach it, attach it to other virtual machines if we wanted to in ARM. But we'll always keep that. The other side of it is private IPs. So in the private IP space, if you look in your virtual network, this may be a case too. So internally, inside your VNet, there may be a case where you say, hey, I need this DNS server to always respond to this IP address for some reason. And in that case, we can basically do the same thing. It's not called reserved, it's more of a static IP. The thing to keep in mind is Azure is doing basically DHCP for all these virtual machines that are up there. And when you're coming up saying, I want a static IP or a private IP, it's basically reserving it, saying, okay, for this particular virtual machine, make sure that it always gets this private IP. Public, same thing. So basically, we're doing a reservation to make sure that we always get those bindings for the IP address to a specific machine, and it doesn't change. And that wraps up our module on VNets and connectivity to Azure services.